So it is now time for oral questions. I recognize the Leader of His Majesty's loyal opposition.
Thank you. And good morning, Speaker. This question's for the Premier. People in Ontario are working harder than ever and paying more than ever for rent, for mortgages, for groceries, for heat and hydro. While they try to make every single dollar stretch, the least they can expect is a government that's going to put every dollar to work for them, building homes, hiring doctors, fixing schools. But for the 6 years that this Conservative government has been in power, people have watched their tax dollars go to insider schemes and big corporations instead of those basics. So my question is, why should any hardworking Ontarian believe that today's economic statement is going to make their lives better when this Premier has only ever put his insiders first?
Reply, the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I find it so ironic coming from the opposition that voted against every tax cut that we've done. Matter of fact, Mr. Speaker, we're the only government in recent memory that has never raised a tax. We reduced the tax. We reduced the tax when it comes to vehicle registration stickers. We reduced the tax on the 412 and 418. We got rid of the tolls, Mr. Speaker. And, Mr. Speaker, the one fare is saving people $1,600 a year traveling back and forth. We reduced the gas tax by 10.7 cents, saving families up to $380 on the average every single year. And, Mr. Speaker, we're finally putting money back into people's pocket rather than the government's. Every single person is going to get a $200 rebate check that they can stimulate the economy. They can go out and maybe buy their kids a pair of sneakers, go out for dinner. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The supplementary question.
You've cut services, you've introduced user fees. Life is harder and more expensive for Ontarians than it has ever been today in the province. And people are stuck, right? They're stuck waiting for a doctor,
government side, come to work.
Waiting for a home they can afford, waiting for someone in power to do something for them. Today's economic statement could take steps to expand truly affordable housing, to put more doctors in our communities, to get lead pipes out of our kids' schools. But instead, people are going to see billions, billions of their tax dollars go to private spa companies and private health companies and anyone else with a connection to this Conservative Party. Why do the Premier's insiders get billions while working people get a one-off check and a pat on the head?
Members can please sit their seat. The Premier.
It's your review the last week. There's so many families that want to have a child and they can't. We put a massive tax credit for IVF. That's going to help over 20,000 families. Mr. Speaker, we announced the stay at, learn and stay, I should say.
Order.
Learn and stay for medical students.
Order.
That are, if they stay in the area for 5 years, we pay for their medical school. We got rid of the 20% of foreign students coming in taking our kids' medical seats. Now it's going to be 100% Canadian, 95% Ontario. Mr. Speaker.
Opposition, come to order.
Then, Mr. Speaker, we announce
response.
We're going to end congestion. We're getting rid of the bike lanes in Toronto and across Ontario. Because, Mr. Speaker, only one.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. The final supplementary. The House will come to order.
Thank you, Speaker. The truth is today that life under this government after 6 long years is harder. It is more expensive than it has ever been before, and Ontarians know that. They know what this $200 check is. They know it's a bid
government
to win
side,
them
come
over
to order.
Before an election, and they're not going to fall for it. They also know what this check is not. It is not a solution to the affordability crisis. It's not going to build the affordable homes people need, and it sure won't get them a family doctor. It's not going to leave them in a better place next month. Speaker, will this fall economic statement give Ontarians what they paid for? Or will they get more headaches instead of homes, delays instead of doctors, and schemes instead of schools?
Members, please take their seats. Premier?
Mr. Speaker, let's reverse 6 years ago when their party, the NDP and the Liberals,
position come to order.
Chased 300,000 jobs out of this province. They were leaving in the droves. Mr. Speaker,
independent members come to
talk
order.
About life being more affordable. There's over 860,000. Let me repeat that. 860,000 people collecting a bigger paycheck because they have a better job under our administration. We're going to continue looking at ways to put money back into people's pockets. The NDP and the Liberals believe in one thing: tax, tax, tax. Leave the province. Take your business down south. We take a different approach. We have seen over $70 billion of investment come to Ontario. We're an economic powerhouse around the world now.
Bonds.
Not just in Canada. We created 43,000 jobs last month. 95% of all the jobs in Canada last month were created here. 165,000 this year alone.
Thank you. Member for Hamilton Mountain will come to order. The member for Ottawa South will come to order. The Minister of Transportation will come to order. The next question, the Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. Look, this is the same government that drove health care workers by the thousands out of this province because they tried to freeze their pay just when we needed them more than ever. So that's a bit rich. People deserve a government that works just as hard as they do, one that puts their tax dollars to work, making their life easier, not more difficult. But after 6 long years of this premier and his costly schemes and all his scandals, people are not getting what they paid for. Just look at health care. Under the Conservatives, fewer people have a doctor. Hallway medicine is worse than it has ever been, even under the Liberals. My goodness. And there's a shortage of medical supplies for people who are relying on home care. My question is, it has been over a month, Speaker. How many people are still facing these shortages today?
Members will please take their seats. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, let's talk about health care. When we walked in, hallway health care, bankrupt system in the health care system, we have spent $33 billion more, total $85 billion. 80,000, let me repeat that, 80,000 new nurses, 12,500 new doctors, 3,500 new acute care beds. We're adding another 3,000 because we're building 50 new hospitals or additions to hospitals with $50 billion. That's what we're doing. We brought Dr. Philpott on side to make sure not only are we leading the country with a connection of Ontario citizens for family physicians, we don't think that's good enough because we only have 88%. We're going to fill that 12% gap. We're putting money towards health care like it's never been before.
Spons.
Just call the CEOs of any hospital in Ontario, ask them, are they getting more support under this government or under the NDP?
Premier will take a seat. The member for Ottawa Centre will come to order. The member for Ottawa South will come to order. Minister of Transportation will come to order. Supplementary question.
Speaker, the proof is in the pudding, right? Under the Liberals, 1,000 people a day were being treated in hallways in our hospitals. Today, that number is double under this government. You know, great job. They had one job to do, Speaker. Get medical supplies to vulnerable home care patients. Just one little thing they had to do. They couldn't get it done. Providing health care is a basic function of a provincial government. It is the right of every single Ontarian. But to this premier, health care is just another opportunity for his insiders to make a buck. That's the truth. While everybody else gets left to fend for themselves, risking infection, injury, worse, they're left trying to source essential medical supplies on Amazon, for goodness sake. So my question is, Are these patients supposed to wait for their $200 check to buy their own medical supplies, or is this premier going to fix the mess?
Members will please take their seats. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, is the Leader of the Opposition calling the 12,500 doctors and the 80,000 nurses that we registered insiders? Because they're the people coming on board, or the 30,000 students, or the $546 million that we're connecting over 600,000 people to primary care. Mr. Speaker, number one priority is always health care, and right beside it is the economy and making sure we have the proper infrastructure that we're doing.
Order.
We're building the 413, we're building the Bradford Bypass, we're building the 400, 401 East, we're putting money into hospitals, putting money into schools. Over $16 billion we've invested in the budget in schools alone. Mr. Speaker, we're rebuilding Ontario from the disaster that we ended up getting when we landed in 2018. I call it the bankrupt province. It's no longer bankrupt. People around the world are talking.
Thank you. Thank you. Member for Sudbury will come to order. The Minister for Red Tape Reduction will come to order. Final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, I'm not sure that anyone who's going without a pain pump or diabetes equipment is going to take comfort in that response from their Premier. As a first priority, people want the supplies they need to keep themselves and their family healthy. Then they want answers as to how this was allowed to happen. We know that Bayshore Health's lobbyist just happens to be the president of the PC Party of Ontario. So I want to know from this premier, maybe that's why he's not rushing to fix this mess. You know, is that why that company got this sweetheart insider deal with Ontario Health at home? And shouldn't that contract require them to actually deliver the supplies?
Order. Order. Members, will please take their seats. Order. 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 The response, the Deputy Premier and Minister of Health.
Mr. Speaker, the members opposite can throw accusations. We'll get things done. As soon as we
order
that there were distribution issues, we understood that we had to assist, and we immediately started working with Ontario Health at Home. We have special assistant teams with this vendor to make sure that people get the critical medical supplies and medications they need. We know it is unacceptable for people who are living at home and needing these supplies to have any delays. Those teams...
Order.
And, in addition, we have ensured that any individual who went out and purchased necessary supplies can get that those supplies.
Opposition, come to order.
Over 80% of those checks are already being distributed, Speaker. We know that we had to take action to ensure that
response.
People get the services they need. But, you know, I have to look at the budget increase that we've had in home care in the province of Ontario. Last year alone, a 10% increase in people accessing home care. We are...
Thank you. Order. The next question, the member for Waterloo.
Thank you very much. My question is for the Premier. Speaker, people across this province are struggling and they are hurting. Their rents are higher. They can't find a family doctor. Kids in our schools are learning in classrooms with leaky roofs, with garbage pails catching the water. Ontario has become a have-not province. Today's fall economic statement gives this government an opportunity to right those wrongs and course correct in a major way. To the Premier, will today's fall economic statement show a government that is willing to invest in the province of this, in the promise of this province? Because this province could be such an amazing place for everybody, not just for the insiders. Or should we expect more stale ideas, beer promises, and bribes from this government?
The House will come to order. I think I can handle this. Appreciate the interventions of the members, but I think I can handle it. I'm going to ask the member to withdraw her unparliamentary comment. To reply, the Minister of Finance.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just take a look at what we're doing in this province. We're rebuilding the economy. We're strengthening our health care. We're tackling gridlock. We're building infrastructure for our growing communities. And, yes, we are balancing the budget, Mr. Speaker. Now, the Premier got up earlier and he talked about how we're building this economy. Mr. Speaker, if you look since 2018, the economy has grown by over $300 billion to $1.1 trillion. You know, that's good for workers, that's good for families, that's good for businesses. They're able to put food on the table, they're able to feel good about themselves. They're growing this province, and we're doing it together under the leadership of this Premier. With all my caucus colleagues, and I'm looking forward to saying more this afternoon at the Fall Economics.
Supplementary question.
Thank you. Speaker, balancing a budget on the backs of the most vulnerable in the province of Ontario is nothing to brag about. Under this government, taxpayers are not getting what they pay for. The government is failing at the very basics: education, health care, affordability, compassion. Our public services are facing a shortfall of $13.1 billion over the next 3 years. They are consumed. This government is consumed with their schemes, their scandals, their fantasy tunnels. They are completely disconnected from the problems of everyday people in this province. Election checks won't make up for the fact that the cost to put a roof over your head has skyrocketed under this Premier. So to the Premier, will today's balance sheet show taxpayers how much of their money is allocated to this pandering schemes at the expense of public service, like health care?
Members, please take their seats. Minister of Finance.
There you have it, Mr. Speaker. They're against putting taxpayer money back in their pockets. They're against families. They're against businesses. They're against building this economy, Mr. Speaker. But it's no surprise. There isn't a tax that they haven't loved, a fee they haven't wanted to increase.
Mission come to order.
Let's just talk. We cut the gas tax again, Mr. Speaker, helping families and businesses right across the province. And their party just up the road, and they support an increase to the carbon tax. So they're taking money. They're taking money out of businesses' pockets.
Order.
They're taking money out
Tide
of people's
come to
pockets.
Order.
That's their solution. I think people are tired of the solutions coming from that opposition. They're supporting this party and our plan to build this province, support workers, to support the family.
Order. The next question, the member for Oxford.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Economic Development, Job Creation and Trade. Good-paying jobs that were lost under the Liberals are being brought back to the province. The Liberals turned their backs on southwestern Ontario, and hard-working families had to pay the price. Under their watch, factories closed, jobs were lost, and our manufacturing capacity was hollowed out. But now our government has created the conditions for job growth in every region of the province. Over the summer, I joined the ministers to welcome important manufacturing investments that will benefit the families in my riding and across the region. Speaker, can the minister please share with this House some of the investments that have been made in Oxford?
Minister of Economic Development, Job Creation and Trade.
Thank you very much, Speaker. And yes, I can share what's happened in Oxford because they are a manufacturing powerhouse. $93 million in new manufacturing has landed in Oxford. ViewTech Canada, automotive parts manufacturer, $40 million investment, 145 new jobs. Transmit Steel, $23 million investment, 17 new jobs. Armtech, great company in Tillsonburg, $27 million to build a brand new facility. MTO Metal Products, a manufacturer of custom metal parts, $2.5 million investment, 16 new jobs. Speaker, these are all investments that are creating great-paying jobs for the hardworking families of Oxford. They're all here because we've lowered the cost of business by $8 billion annually.
Response?
And these jobs are part of the 860,000 new jobs we've created in Ontario.
Supplementary, the member from Mississauga, Moulton.
Speaker, in 2023, Ontario created more manufacturing jobs than all 50 U.S. states combined. Our manufacturing sector that was crushed under the Liberals is thriving again. Speaker, it is a contrasting tale of two leaderships. The Liberals were content with watching goods that were once made in Ontario moving out. On the contrast, our government under the leadership of Premier Ford has created the condition to restore Ontario's manufacturing might to all the job creators. If you're looking a place to invest, Ontario's that place. Over the summer, I have joined the minister to welcome an important investment in Mississauga. It's such a refreshing news that the good-paying jobs are being created right here in the province of Ontario. Can the minister please provide this legislature an update or any other investment and expansion that is happening right here in the province of Ontario?
Thank you very much. Minister of Economic Development, Job Creation and Trade.
Thank you, Speaker. We are seeing job-creating investments in every single part of our province. Speaker, we were in Mississauga, Moulton with the member as we cut the ribbon at First Choice Beverage. Now, they are a Canadian producer of juice and dairy alternative products. They are investing $50 million to boost their manufacturing capacity at their Mississauga facility, creating 20 new good-paying jobs along the way. With the member from Kitchener-Conestoga, we cut the ribbon at, turned the sod at Golden Windows. This is a $30 million investment. They're an Ontario-based manufacturer of windows and doors. They're building a 240,000 square foot facility in Kitchener, adding 50 new good-paying jobs. Speaker, we've supported 135 projects, leveraged $1.9 billion in new investment, and helped creating 3,500 new jobs.
Amazing. Thank you. The next question, the member for Nickel Belt.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Ma question pour la ministre.
My question is to the Health Minister.
From all over the province are still reaching out to me about the crisis in home care medical supplies. The minister's decisions to hand off the last miles of medical supply delivery to Bayshore is leaving palliative care patients in pain. It is also hurting small businesses who for years have been handling medical supplies delivery to their communities, to their neighbors, and they all lost their contract. This decision is bad for patients. It is bad for small businesses. Speaker, how could this minister make a worse decisions for home care patients and small businesses?
The Deputy Premier and Minister of Health.
While the member opposite and her party were voting down every single investment that we were making in home care in the province of Ontario, they were voting against it. We have increased home care capacity in the province of Ontario. Yes, absolutely
Order.
Unacceptable that people cannot get their medical supplies and necessary medications on time, but we have acted quickly to ensure that Ontario embeds themselves into that vendor to make sure that they get the necessary supplies, prioritizing palliative care patients, prioritizing people who need those necessary pieces of equipment. And we are seeing improvements. But I am not going to apologize for something that the vendor has done. We need
Order.
To make sure that today, right now, it is focused on the patient and making sure
Response.
That they get those supplies. We'll continue to do that work, and I hope that the next time we expand home care in the province of Ontario, your party...
Thank you. Order. Member for St. Catharines, come to order. Member for Windsor West, come to order. Member for Nickel Belt.
Thank you, Speaker. I'm glad the minister recognizes that this crisis in home care is her responsibility.
Right.
There are other crises in health care. A year ago, Catherine from Cornwall had her prescription renewed for a full year because her doctor was retiring and he knew full well that a walk-in clinic would not renew it. She has spent the last 11 months trying to find a doctor with no success. Ask the MPP for Stormont Dundas. He knows all about it. My constituent, Yvon, died of cardiac arrest last spring at the age of 60. 2 years after retirement, Yvon's doctor retired in 2020. His wife, Stasha, is absolutely certain that he would still be there if he had had access to a family doctor. Will the minister admit today that she's also created the crisis in primary care?
Members will please take their seats. The Deputy Premier and Minister of Health.
So in 2023 budget, we invested $1 billion in home care. You voted against. In the 2024 budget, we invested $2 billion in home care, which you voted against. Our additional investments mean that over 700,000 people are now accessing home care in the province of Ontario that were unable to prior to. You will hear in today's financial economic statement an investment and expansion of a Learn and Stay program that has been incredibly successful for nurses, for Northern Ontario paramedics, for lab techs, and we're now expanding that program to physicians who choose to study for family medicine in the province of Ontario. The investments that we are making, whether it is in the short, the long, or the medium term, mean that finally we have a government and a premier who is investing
response.
The necessary money to ensure that our home care and our health care is there for the people who need it across Ontario.
Thank you. The next question, the member for Scarborough Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Transportation. Costs keep rising in Ontario in terms of grocery, gas, everything is more expensive. And the Trudeau Crombie carbon tax is making it worse. Our government has not raised tax, and we are working to keep costs down for family. The previous Liberal government raised tax year after year after year, Mr. Speaker. They raised tax on everything. Unlike the Liberals and the NDP, our government believe that we should work to make life easier for people of Ontario. Speaker, can the minister please share what our government is doing to help keep money back in people's pocket?
Member for Hastings, Lennox and Addington, Parliamentary Assistant.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member for that question. Our government is focused on making life easier for the people of Ontario, whether it's building new transit and highways to make it easier to get around or taking steps to save people money. We are focused on ensuring that Ontario remains one of the best places to live, work, and raise a family. The previous government's record is clear. They introduced a provincial carbon tax. They raised fees on driver's licenses. They raised fees on drive clean. And they raised the gas tax, making it more expensive to fill your tank. Our government has taken a different approach. We cut the provincial carbon tax. We froze driver's license fees. We removed the fee on the drive clean program, and we have cut the gas tax by over 10 cents a litre. Speaker, our PC government, under the leadership of this premier, will continue to put more money back in people's pockets and save
response.
Families money.
The supplementary question, back to the member for Scarborough Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Parliamentary Assistant, for his answer. Our government needs to make life easier for family and business in Ontario. But when family need help, Bonnie Crombie and the Liberals keep voting against saving people money. Bonnie. Speaker, they are out of touch, elite and expensive when they were in power. They ignore Ontarians. I know the Premier and our government are taking action to save people money. Speaker, can the Parliamentary Assistant share more about what our government is doing to make life more affordable to people in Ontario? Thank you.
And the Parliamentary Assistant Member for Hastings, Lennox and Addington to respond.
Speaker, and thank you to my friend from Scarborough Centre. Speaker, it's disappointing that the Liberals and the NDP refuse to support common sense solutions to make life more affordable. They voted against the One Fare program, Speaker. They voted against removing double fares for transit riders between GO Transfer and local transit agencies. Speaker, the One Fare program saves the average commuter $1,600 per year.
Wow.
When she was the mayor of Mississauga, Liberal leader Bonnie Crombie raised Mississauga transit fares for students, for adults, and for seniors. Speaker, the difference couldn't be more clear. We're standing up to save families money. The NDP and the Liberals want to make life more expensive. My colleague is right. The Liberals and the NDP could not be more out of touch. We're the only party fighting to keep costs down for the people of Ontario. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you very much. The next question, the member for Ottawa West, Nepean.
Thank you, Speaker. While our kids are in schools with floods, crumbling ceilings, and lead in the drinking water, this government is forcing school boards to print and post signs at schools promoting the government. They are even making school boards pay for the signs with funds that could be going to fix the schools or, you know, getting the lead out of the drinking water. How can the Minister of Education justify this scenario to taxpayers who expect their money to go to safe and healthy schools for our kids rather than to self-promotion by a government in trouble?
Member for Markham Unionville and Parliamentary Assistant.
Member for the question. My ministry consistently allocates almost $1.4 billion each year to school boards to renew and improve their school facilities. These investments are making a difference on the ground in schools, such as HV improvements, roof repairs, and renewal of building electrical and plumbing systems. Unfortunately, Speaker, while we were making the necessary improvement in schools, boards were not even spending all the money we were giving them, leading to hundreds of millions of dollars being carried forward each year. So this practice was not a good use of our tax dollars, and as a result, we had to introduce time limits for spending school renewal allocations. The members of the opposition should be thanking us for ensuring that taxpayer money is now being used efficiently rather than defending fiscal waste
opposition
and mismanagement.
Order.
We are ensuring that our public dollars are being used efficiently while also ensuring that students can continue to learn in a safe and secure setting.
Well said. Thank you. Supplementary question. Supplementary question.
This isn't the first time we've seen such incredible disrespect from this government, Speaker. Last year, the Auditor General criticized the Minister of Education for spending over $4 million in taxpayer dollars on partisan ads. According to the Auditor General, these ads put forward claims that lacked context or evidence. The government spent this money while kids didn't have mental health supports, education assistance, or even teachers. Why does this government constantly think they can use public money for self-promotion instead of where Ontario residents want to see it go, towards supporting our kids?
No response? Member for Brampton West and Parliamentary Assistant.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. While my colleague has explained that it is not a new requirement to have Ontario build signs on capital projects, like new schools and renovations. But what Mr. Speaker, the member opposite failed to mention is that these are the same school boards who spent $3,800,000, wasted $3,800,000 on Blue Jay games. Mr. Speaker, they wasted $145,000 on a lavish trip to Italy, Mr. Speaker. The opposition party can play politics on this issue, Mr. Speaker. What we are focused on is we're focused on building schools. We're focused on building childcare spaces, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the Minister of Education for announcing two new schools in my riding of Brampton West, Mr. Speaker. We're focused on making investments. We're focused on building medical schools. We're focused on building hospitals, Mr. Speaker. You know what these blue signs mean, Mr. Speaker? These blue signs means we're making investments.
Order. Order. The next question, the member for Kingston and the Islands.
Speaker, we hear countless stories from the 2.5 million Ontarians this government has left without a family doctor. Two constituents in Kingston and the Islands who served with the Canadian Forces were left with no family doctor when they finished their service. One is a teacher who was sent overseas for a two-year posting, and when they returned, couldn't get re-rostered with their local clinic anymore. Another is a discharged CF member who has mental health complications, uses walk-in clinics, but struggles with having to explain their mental health history over and over again every time they see a new doctor. I ask this government, why is this okay? Would the minister make a way for people who have served with the military to have family doctors when they finish serving their country?
The Deputy Premier and Minister of Health.
Thank you. The member opposite raises an important issue, and I'm happy to take that away and see what we can do. But I also have to ask him that look in the mirror. Look at your party's history. You were a party that cut 50 medical seats, which now means that almost 350 physicians that could have been trained in the province of Ontario are not here. Do a compare and contrast. While you were cutting medical seats while you were in government, we have expanded. We've expanded medical seats in every single medical school in the province of Ontario, almost doubling them in Northern Ontario School of Medicine. We have now announced, and next September, we will have a medical school in the city of Brampton. The contrast between what you did while your party was in government and what we have been able to do in six short years
Response.
And will continue to do with now the announcement and ensuring that Dr. Philpott is leading primary care expansion in the province, that's getting...
Thank you. Supplementary question.
Speaker, this doesn't have to be so partisan. I once attended a dinner to recruit a New York family doctor at Kingston. What might they have heard? Well, OHIP billing hasn't paid for inflated costs. And then this government lowballed doctors during the latest fee negotiations, making an offer the arbitrator called, quote, completely unrealistic. What else did they hear? Well, the system makes doctors spend hours phoning around their networks, begging specialists to take their patients, handling the deluge of faxes on meds checks for minor ailments, or tracking down a missing fax the hospital sent to the MPP's home phone by mistake. This New York doctor might have been swayed by the 5,000 Ontario family doctors who walked away from family medicine. So why won't this government just fix the system and get more family doctors for the 2.5 million who don't have one?
Question.
Because they don't know how.
Stop the clock. Oh, I'm sure that's an interesting conversation underway between the member for Ottawa South and the Minister of Labour, Immigration, Training and Skills Development, but question period is still underway, and I'd ask them to wait until after question period's over, perhaps, to continue the conversation. Start the clock. Minister of Health to reply.
With the greatest of respect, the member opposite just admitted what hadn't been done on the previous Liberal government. Absolutely dealing with this. We have been seized with it since Premier Ford came into office. Expansion of medical schools, expansion of seats, expansion to ensure that our residency students who want to practice in Ontario, who want to have a seat in Ontario, will now have that as a result of this afternoon's fall economic statement. We are absolutely getting this done. But frankly, if the two parties opposite had actually done their planning and their work, we would not be in this position, and we would not have to be rebuilding the way we have to.
Thank you very much. The next question, the member for Markham, Thornhill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Infrastructure. Across Ontario, we know there is a housing crisis. Communities are growing. Young people, families, and new Ontarians all need places to call home. But building homes is only part of the answer. We also need the right infrastructure to support those homes, roads, schools, especially water system. Because without the proper water system, wastewater infrastructure, new housing cannot be happened. It is one thing it's approved housing, but is another one to ensure those houses have the infrastructure they need. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please update the legislature on water, what our government is doing to ensure municipalities have the water system in place to support the new housing? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. The member for Brampton West and parliamentary assistant can reply for the government.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member for the question. I'm very honored to have the opportunity to rise in the legislature this morning to speak about our government is doing to accelerate housing starts, particularly with our Housing Enabling Water Systems Fund. Speaker, our government was re-elected with an even large mandate on the commitment that we would get housing and infrastructure built. Through the Housing Enabling Water Systems Fund, we're doing just that. Our $970 million investment for water and wastewater is paving the way for all municipalities all over the province, and we hear the good news every day. And for those municipalities that haven't applied yet, I have got good news for you. The second intake of applications is currently open. The deadline to apply is 4:59 p.m. on November 1st, 2024. If your municipality wants to build, our government will stand side by side with them, get shovels in the ground, and get it done.
Thank you. Supplementary question.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you for the parliamentary assistant for the response. In every part of our province, we see the need for more homes. We know that our communities are ready to grow, and we know that they need the right support to make it happen. Local leaders are telling us they are ready to build, and people are eager to move in. But we know that building homes is only one part of the plan. Without the right funding for the essential infrastructure, they are limited in what they can do. Water and water infrastructure system are not just extras. They are necessities for any new home to get built. This funding can make all the difference, bringing jobs and homes to these communities. Mr. Speaker, could the parliamentary assistant please share how this funding is impacting local economy and helping municipality keep housing costs low? Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Member for Brampton West.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member for that supplementary question. Mr. Speaker, I, Minister Surma, and Premier Ford had the privilege of spending their busy summer traveling across Ontario, seeing firsthand how this funding will positively benefit municipalities and Ontarians. Just this past Monday, Premier Ford announced $34.9 million in funding, which will help build over 3,300 homes in Greater Sudbury. We know these actions get results, Mr. Speaker, and so does Mayor LaFebvre of Sudbury, who told our government this $35 million investment is truly historic infrastructure investment in Greater Sudbury, the largest one-time funding commitment we have ever received from the province. When Minister Surma was in Vaughan to announce $35 million, which will support the construction of 20,000 homes, former Liberal leader and current Vaughan Mayor Stephen Del Duca said, and I quote, "We are in the midst of housing affordability crisis."
Response.
And this is an all hands on deck moment for all leaders. I look forward to continuing to work with the provincial government to build a brighter future. Speaker, what every municipality that received funding had in common was this municipality's want to build housing.
Thank you. Thank you. The next question, the member for Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. It has been over 2 weeks since Logan went missing from his home in Havelock, Belmont, Methuen. A vulnerable autistic 18-year-old who has other needs, including ADHD and anxiety. Over a year and a half ago, I stood in this House and introduced a critical and vital private member's bill, Bill 74, Missing Persons Amendment Act. Bill 74 is at the Standing Committee of Justice Policy, stalled with no action. It has been there since March. Premier, when are you going to bring back Bill 74, pass it, and help missing persons like Logan be located close to home?
The government house leader.
Thanks very much, Speaker. Through you to the member. You know, I understand private members' bills can be a bit of a frustrating process. I had a question the other day from the member for Carleton, and I quoted a stat that when I first came into the legislature in 2010, I was told, and that's since Confederation,
order.
The member, if the member will allow me to answer her question. When I was first here, I was told by legislative research that since Confederation, about 3% of private members' bills actually make it into legislation.
Order.
If the member will allow me to answer, I've had private members' bills passed, and I've been pretty lucky because I made a decision that rather than playing politics on the floor about standing committees, I'd actually roll up my sleeve, walk across the floor, and talk to the minister involved.
Response.
And ask how we can work together. I was successful. I made some decisions. I say to the member, you can make those same decisions.
Order. The member for Hamilton Mountain, supplementary.
Speaker, I can't control what happens on the government side. All I know is that the former government House leader promised a family that this would be passed, that this would become law, that this would save lives. Unfortunately, the new House leader does not see it that way. He'd rather play politics. So, thankfully, as of this morning, Logan has been found 16 days after he left his home. Many in the community were unaware that Logan was even missing. The OPP used every tool they had available. An alert was not one of them. Bill 74 would have brought another option, a localized and swift action to alert those who may have seen Logan within those 2 weeks. It would have been another tool in the toolbox to ensure our most vulnerable people have those around them looking out on high alert. Premier, I'm thankful that Logan has been located. This could have happened sooner. When are you going to pass Bill 74 so all tools are available when vulnerable people go missing in our communities?
Members will please take their seats. Government House Leader.
Speaker, through you to the member, on behalf of the government, we're so pleased that Logan has been found and is safe. We want to thank all of the first responders, everyone that worked on this. It's a real testament to how the system works. And again, I'm very pleased that Logan has been found. I've said to the member, there are ways to work collaboratively on private members' bills. I know the numbers are not in their favour, but I can say from myself, my private members' bill, I tabled it 3 times, I amended it 3 times, I sat with the minister,
I was
able to have that collaboration. And again, I hope that the member will take my advice. But again, on behalf of the government, we want to say to Logan and his family, we're so pleased that the outcome is what it is.
Response.
We want to thank the first responders for doing such a great job.
The next question. The next question, the member for Scarborough-Guildwood.
My question is for the Premier. Today, the government will release their fall economic statement. This will be their sixth one since 2018. Six, Mr. Speaker. Six statements. And what do they have to show for it? Well, 2,000 people are there being treated in emergency waiting rooms, hallways and stairwells. ER wait times have increased by 48%. 11,000 people died waiting for surgery or diagnostic procedures. 2.5 million Ontarians do not have a family doctor. In my riding, seniors tell me they are scared to get sick because they see the state of the ERs. So, if this government has had 5 chances to show they care about health care, why should anybody believe them the sixth time around?
The Deputy Premier and Minister of Health.
Well, thank you for the member opposite to allow me to do a bit of a recap of what has been happening in the last 6 years. Rebuilding a health care system that was frankly ignored under previous NDP and Liberal governments. As I've said previously, 2 new medical schools in Brampton, in Scarborough, in York Region, and in York Region, they are going to actually practice and train family physicians focused. medical schools across the province of Ontario, every single medical school in the province of Ontario now has additional seats available for students who want to practice and train in the province of Ontario, expanding the number of residency seats that are available in the province of Ontario. The first year I was elected as and appointed to the Ministry of Health, directing the College of Physicians and Surgeons to quickly assess, review, and ultimately license internationally educated physicians. You know, I know the member opposite doesn't want to hear this,
order.
But the truth is we are making investments that you
order.
Ignored and your party ignored for far too long.
Thank you, Speaker.
Member for Don Valley East will come to order. Supplementary question.
Well, Mr. Speaker, it's back to the Premier. I understand what this government priorities are based on information I just received. And it's basically even not the 32,000 residents in Etobicoke North who do not have a family doctor. Six statements. Let me tell you what the government has to show for it. An $8.3 billion Greenbelt giveaway, a criminal RCMP investigation, $1 billion just to get booze in the corner stores a year earlier, negotiated one of the worst deals in Ontario's history, spending $2 billion of taxpayers' money to sell off Ontario Place to a foreign-owned spa. All of this while 1,200 ERs were closed in 2023, 200,000 people are waiting for tests, 11,000 deaths waiting for addiction treatment. This is the state of healthcare in Ontario. Today, will he finally make healthcare a priority, or will he continue to focus on his friends and instead of the people of his province?
Never did, never will.
Minister of Health.
Oh, Speaker, I'm not done. Facts matter. So 50 Capitol build expansions, including in Scarborough Health Network, a community that has been ignored for far too long. We're making that investment in the Scarborough Health Network. We're making sure that students
Order.
Who want to practice and train as primary care practitioners, as clinicians, as nurses, are getting those opportunities in Scarborough. And then when I think of our February announcement, 78 new or expanded primary care expansion teams across Ontario. We are getting it done because we are making the investments in our young people, in our students, in our capital projects, in our hospitals, in our community care, and
Order.
Yes, even in hospice, because we understand that healthcare is a system. When I had the
Response?
Opportunity to go and announce that for the first hospice in the province of Ontario, and indeed Canada, will indeed be on First Nations land, that's getting it.
Thank you. The next question, the member for Essex.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Seniors and Accessibility. Seniors in my riding of Essex are looking for ways to stay active and involved in the community. They want to stay socially connected because they know that social isolation is enemy number one. They want to have access to programs and services that are specifically designed for seniors, and they want to have those programs in Essex County, close to their homes in Essex County. Speaker, can the Minister for Seniors and Accessibility please tell the House what our government is doing to help seniors stay active and socially connected?
And to reply, the Minister for Seniors and Accessibility.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to thank member from Essex for that very important question and thank him for working so hard for seniors in Essex. We just recently issued the quarterly funds of over $3.8 million to 316 senior active living centers across Ontario. That is why we are able to open two brand new centers in excess past year. This funding makes sure that our seniors in excess and all of Ontario have programs and services that keep our seniors fit, active, healthy, socially connected, close to their homes,
Response.
In their communities, and they could avoid social isolation. Thank you.
Thank you. And the supplementary question.
I thank the minister for that answer. It's exciting to know that the government of Ontario is providing programs and services to help people in my riding. And seniors need to know that the funds for those programs and services that we're talking about are going to be there for them, in their communities and close to their homes. I'm talking about communities like Amherstburg and Kingsville and Bell River. Those are places right in Essex County. And seniors in these communities are looking to the government to commit to the funding, not just today, but also in the future. Speaker, will the minister please tell us how much money will those seniors' active living centres receive, and will that funding stay in place?
Minister for Seniors and Accessibility.
Mr. Speaker, thanks to Premier Ford, I can assure the member the senior active living centres will continue to receive the funding needed so that seniors receive the programs and services and they deserve. This is why every senior active living center is now receiving up to $50,000 a year, up from $42,000 last year. This shows we are not only committed to maintain the funding, but we have expanded funding for these important centers. These senior centers are doing great things for our seniors, and thanks to our leadership, we are getting it done for seniors in Essex and all of Ontario. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The next question, the member for Thunder Bay, Atikokan.
Interesting, Lo, because this week I received a letter from a constituent in the neighbouring riding of Thunder Bay, Atikokan, asking me to lobby for the same heat pump rebates offered to Kenora and 16 other Ontario municipalities. The grants are for $5,000 for above ground and $10,000 for ground source heat pumps. If people in Kenora, Barrie, Ottawa and Toronto are being offered these subsidies, what is stopping the province from offering the same heat pump subsidies to all communities in Ontario?
Minister of Energy and Electrification.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. I want to thank the member for the question. The member has accurately defined a problem that is solved in the Affordable Energy Act. I would encourage the members opposite to read the legislation that's tabled in this House. You would think they would vote in favour of it, because what the Act does is it gives the IESO, the Independent Electricity Systems Operator, the capacity and the legal ability to provide efficiency programs to every region of Ontario, not just to constrained regions, which currently represent 30% of the population. So if the member is urging the government to help all families access heat pumps or conservation initiatives or home renovations, then they will announce today support for the Affordable Energy Act.
Supplementary, the member for Thunder Bay, Superior North.
Is accurate? Hooray! I look forward to being able to tell the people of Marathon who asked me to, they would like to see their community switch to heat pumps as a way to reduce their carbon footprint and reduce costs. But it is puzzling that there were 17 communities offered those rebates when so many other communities were not offered anything. So I don't know what's so special about Kenora, for example, but communities on the north shore of Lake Superior and many other communities on Highway 11 and going as far north to Nakina, heating is provided by electric baseboards, oil, propane, or wood, and they could all benefit enormously from a transition to heat pumps. So I would like to hear, let's hear it, yes. Sounds like it could be a yes. Will it be a yes? Will the government provide the same opportunities offered to Kenora
Order.
To all other communities in Ontario?
The Minister of Energy and Electrification. Members will please take their seats.
Mr. Speaker, the member asked rhetorically, what's so special about Kenora? I would argue there's a lot of special things about Northwestern Ontario. Every region of Ontario is worthy of conservation. The driver behind the Affordable Energy Act is to reduce the bills after they increased by 300% of the former Liberals. I think the member and I would agree of the disastrous record that we cannot go back to. The difference, though, between the opposite New Democrats and Conservatives is we're standing up against the carbon tax, which exacerbates, which compounds the problem in Northern Ontario as prices increase because it's expensive to use. Yes, home heating for home oil, oil heating for this winter. So, Madam Speaker, Mr. Speaker, if the objective is to lower bills, if the objective is to expand conservation to all regions, not just to 30%, then I urge the members put money where their mouth is and vote for the Affordable Energy Act.
The next question, the member for Sault Ste. Marie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Northern Development. Mr. Speaker, communities in the north, like my own of Sault Ste. Marie, have some challenges. As we like to say, sometimes we have to work twice as hard to get half as far in the north, and certainly specifically in my community of the Sioux. This is not an area that is treated so fondly in the past by the NDP Liberal Coalition, who once referred to a place like Sault Ste. Marie as a no-man's land, or Northern Ontario as a no-man's land. So, Speaker, I know we have some challenges. We recognize there's challenge. Perhaps the Minister can tell this House what some of the steps are and some of the specific investments our government is making to help people in the north who face some of these very specific challenges and struggles in the area.
Parliamentary Assistant and Member for Brantford Grant.
No, thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the member for his question and his tireless advocacy for the North. Very much appreciated. Speaker, upon being elected in 2018, the Ministry of Northern Development went through a strategic redesign of the Northern Ontario Heritage Fund Corporation. The new and improved, revamped NOHFC now serves more business owners, more communities, and more Indigenous workers than ever before. Under the Liberals, about 1% of the NOHFC investments went to Indigenous businesses and communities. And Speaker, I'd like to announce that thanks to our revamping, we are proud that last year we had a business quarter where 20% of the investments went to Indigenous businesses and communities. Speaker, the NOHFC fosters economic growth, job creation, and workforce development throughout the North, benefiting communities of all sizes, both rural and urban, including Indigenous communities. Since June of 2018, the NOHFC has invested more than $841 million in 6,894 projects in Northern Ontario. Speaker, we are going to continue making strategic investments across the North so that families can thrive and live their best lives. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes our business. That concludes our business for this morning. Right. This House stands in recess.